That was the overture for Saïra opera in three acts. That was composed by Roger Waters and Rick Wentworth from the album Saïra, There Is Hope. And Saïra is actually a song that was composed during the French Revolution for the people to celebrate the idea of freedom and democracy. My name's Malcolm Byrne. You're listening to The Long Way Round here on Radio Kingston. Tonight, my guest is Dimitri Lascaris. Dimitri has been on the show several times. The first time I interviewed him, he was getting ready to go to Russia on a fact-finding mission that he was paying for himself independently. The second time I spoke to Dimitri, he was actually in Russia. And yesterday I spoke to him from some undisclosed location in Greece, where he is now located. But for the last month or two, he's been on a Canadian speaking tour talking about, talking about the lunacy of this current conflict in Ukraine. I guess I'll put it that way. So I've invited him to share his thoughts, not only on his trip to Russia, but also some of the things that he spoke about. Just so to familiarize you as the listeners with Dimitri. Dimitri Lascaris is a lawyer, journalist, and activist. And after graduating from the University of Toronto Faculty in Law in 1991, Dimitri began his legal career at the Wall Street law firm of Sullivan and Cromwell, first working from the firm's New York offices and then joining the firm's offices in Paris, France. While working at Sullivan and Cromwell, Dimitri represented large financial institutions, including Goldman Sachs, in connection with major securities offerings. One such offering was the sale to the public of Allstate Insurance Company, which was at the time the largest initial public offering of stock in the United States history. In 2004, Dimitri joined one of Canada's leading class action law firms, Siskins LLP. While at Siskins, Dimitri co-founded and led Canada's largest and most accomplished team of securities class action lawyers. From 2014 to 16, the Siskins Securities Class Actions team recovered more than $450 million for aggrieved investors. In 2021, Dimitri joined the Toronto-based law firm Callaghan Myers LLP, and in 22, Dimitri and his colleagues at Callaghan Myers secured a $126 million settlement in the CanTrust Securities Class Action. In 2012, he was named Canadian Lawyer Magazine as one of the 25 most influential lawyers. And in 2023, he was named Canadian Business Magazine as one of the 50 most influential persons in Canadian business. From 2012 to 2022, Dimitri was a correspondent and board member of the Real News Network. He's also served on the boards of numerous other public interest, not-for-profit corporations, including the Unity Project for the Relief of Homelessness, Pro Bono Ontario, and Toronto 350. In 2014, Dimitri presented Toronto 350's fossil fuels divestment petition to the president of the University of Toronto. In the 2015 federal election, Dimitri ran for the Green Party of Canada in the riding of London, Ontario West. Subsequently, he served as justice critic in the shadow cabinet of the Green Party of Canada and as justice critic in the shadow cabinet of the Green Party of Quebec. In 2018, he was elected to be a member of the PVO's executive committee. In March 2020, Dimitri announced his candidacy for the leadership of the Green Party of Canada. The leadership contest concluded in 2020, October, that is, of 2020. Dimitri finished in second place out of eight candidates, garnering 45.5% of the votes on the eighth and final ballot. Dimitri's website can be found at Dimitri Lascaris, that's Dimitri Lascaris, Lascaris.org. And I will now play both parts of the interview that I conducted with Dimitri just yesterday. So here we go. Please stay tuned. Sorry, pardon me while I just configure my outputs here. It's always fun when you're working by yourself. Let's see. Where's my output? There we go. Hang on. I'm going to play some music while I do this. So don't go anywhere.
I think of a world without war. People ask me, what you think that for? It'll never happen, not in a million years. Not around here. I think of a world without greed. Most everybody get mostly what they need. It'll never happen, not no place, not the human race. Make up all these stories, try to explain. Snakes and apples, Abel and Cain. Sin. All that pointless evil, you know what I mean. It'll never happen, and I know how. Best give up now. It'll never happen, that's what we always say. Stays that way.
That was a track called World Without War by an artist that I only just recently discovered by the name of Louis Ludwig from his most recent album, I've Got Nothing to Say. That's not really true. Louis has a lot to say, but he's an understated fellow. Anyway, on with the program. Now got things working. So here's my interview with Dimitri Lascaris. Well, welcome. How are you doing?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. So the last time we spoke, you were still in Russia, and now you're back in Canada. How's that transition felt for you?
Actually, I'm in Greece, so
oh.
It was.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's why I'm up in a little stone house on a mountain with a weak internet connection. But I was in Canada from early June to about 5 days ago, and most of that time was consumed with a cross-Canada tour about peace, which was very, very intense and. Very eventful, shall we say.
Yeah, well, tell me about that. I did actually see a couple of your engagements. I saw the most recent one in Toronto, and it was incredible what you were saying, but perhaps you could reiterate some of those thoughts.
Well, thank you. I hope the message is resonating with the people who've had a chance to hear the message of this tour, but in essence, what happened was when I came back, a group of peace activists across the country, one particular peace activist at a place called Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War, his name is Ken Stone, He proposed that I do a tour to discuss with Canadians what I saw in Russia and what I felt was a potential path to peace. And he assembled a coalition of peace groups around the country. And we went to 11 cities in 14 days. And in four of those cities, we had venues cancel on us at the last minute. And ultimately, we were able to overcome the cancellations in all of those cases. But it was, you know, Malcolm, people who know that, who've kind of been familiar with the work I've been doing for years, know that I spent a lot of time in the Palestinian Solidarity Movement. And, you know, that's been a rough ride, because defending the Palestinian cause in Canada is not easy. I never thought I'd experience anything quite like something which was, you know, far more challenging and difficult than that. But this was, you know, the fundamental message of the tour is we are dealing here with an existentially dangerous war happening against the backdrop of an existentially dangerous climate crisis. And the war is distracting us. If it doesn't kill us all through a nuclear Armageddon, it will definitely distract us for years to come from the, you know, the absolutely primordial need to address the climate crisis. And we have to do something about this. And it seems to me that a rational and sane human being would listen to the other side, try to appreciate what their concerns are, however difficult that may be, and try to find a mutual compromise. And the fundamental problem we have here is that our side, the West, seems to have absolutely zero interest in compromise of any kind. And I think that's extremely dangerous. So, you know, there was a lot more, obviously, I'm sure you know that, but that was it in a nutshell.
Yeah. Well, so you got back, when did you actually get back from Russia? That was, gosh, a couple of months ago now, was it?
Well, yeah, I spend, 4 or 5 months a year in Greece, where my family's from. And I have family here. So when I finished Russia on April 30th, I came back to Greece.
Okay.
And I stayed here until, I believe it was late May. And, you know, here in Greece, it's interesting. I mean, first of all, Greeks aren't, viscerally hostile to the Russians. And secondly, it's easier for me to, shall we say, be anonymous here. I've spent much less of my country and my life in this country than I have in Canada. So I didn't really feel the reaction, this extraordinarily hostile reaction until I got back to Canada in late May. And then when we announced this tour, all I can describe it as is, you know, all hell broke loose. But I have to express the utmost admiration for the activists on the ground who were dealing with this and managed to overcome every single cancellation. It was really quite inspiring, actually.
So what was the gist of your message when you were talking to people? I mean, what were some of the main points that you were saying?
Well, first of all, I started by describing what I view as the danger of this moment, that I agree with Noam Chomsky that this is the most dangerous moment in human history. I don't think that that's alarmism or an exaggeration at all. I pointed out that, the policies that are taken by the West with respect to this war are actually exceptional at a global level, which is to say that outside of the West, almost nobody is imposing sanctions on Russia. And outside of the West, almost nobody is sending weapons to either party in the conflict, including the Ukrainians. We in the West have adopted an exceptional approach to this war, which is something, you know, we have a tendency to do. We view ourselves as being exceptional. I think we're horribly mistaken about that. And if we actually sit back and ask ourselves, why are most countries in this world representing a large majority of the human population not taking this approach, this belligerent escalatory approach that we've taken? I think it's because they understand that there is a complex history here, and that this is not a Hollywood action flick with Zelensky playing the role of Obi-Wan Kenobi and Vladimir Putin playing the role of Darth Vader. This is actually a conflict in which there's a lot of blame to go around, and it started well before the invasion in February of 2022. And it has a lot to do with NATO expansion right up to the borders of Russia. It has to do with a coup in Ukraine in 2014, which was essentially orchestrated by Victoria Nuland and others in the State Department, the United States State Department. It has to do with the problem of neo-Nazism in Ukraine, which is serious. And it has to do with the failure of the Ukrainian government not to respect the Minsk Accords. So, as I say, we bear a tremendous amount of responsibility for this war, and I think most of the world understands that, and they've adopted a policy which reflects that. I hope that despite the difficulties of this, of communicating this message to my fellow Westerners, Canadians, Americans, you know, whatever part of the West they may come from, that people will sit back and reflect upon the danger of this moment and ask themselves whether, in fact, they're being fair to our enemy. I don't think they are.
What was the basis of the antagonism and the hostility towards you? I mean, where do you think that comes from, and what do you think the nature of it is?
I think it was, you know,
in Canada
twofold.
Specifically, I should say.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's probably similar everywhere throughout the West, but certainly what I experienced in Canada was this belief, which has been just drilled into our heads, that if you say something which coincides with a position taken by the Russian government, that you're disseminating, as they put it, Putin talking points, you're a Kremlin agent, you're an apologist for the Russian government. And what I've tried to tell people is I don't take at face value any claim being made by any government that is involved in this existentially dangerous war, whether it be the Russian government, the Ukrainian government, the British, the Americans, and the whole of NATO, of course, is deeply involved in this war. What I do is I test the claims of each side, and what we should all do, against the evidence, the objective, credible evidence. And we should ask ourselves, is this supported by the evidence? And if it happens to be supported by the evidence, we shouldn't pretend that it's a Putin talking point just because it's a position taken by the Russian government. Okay, we shouldn't. Basically, what we've been trained to do, frankly, like poodles, is to assume that everything that the Russian government says is false. And therefore, if you say something which coincides with a position taken by that government, you're an agent of its propaganda. But in fact, oftentimes what it has said and what it continues to say has a basis in the historical record. And so it's really the first sort of source of hostility was just tackling the idea that, you know, maybe, just maybe, sometimes the Russian government is saying the truth. Not always, certainly, but sometimes it's telling the truth. Let's look at the evidence and see if it supports it. But the thing that really drove people crazy, I mean, that was enough of a challenge, but when you started talking about us making compromises in order to achieve a peace deal, that just sent people, you know, who've been sort of, you know, getting drunk on the NATO Kool-Aid into a frenzy. Oh my God, we can't make compromises. It's out of the question. You know, I kept hearing over and over again, Putin's a bully and Ukraine is a victim. Well, one could look at this and say that the much bigger bully is NATO, which spends 20 times more than Russia does on its military every year, which has hundreds more military bases than the Russian Federation, which has laid waste to countries throughout the global South, like Libya and Syria and Afghanistan, which broke its promise not to expand eastward. So who is the real bully here? You know, and if you appreciate that, as I say, there are legitimate complaints on the Russian side, and you actually appreciate the danger of this war, the same humane, rational thing to do is to compromise. Not without demanding reciprocal compromises, of course. But this is idea that, you know, we should compromise anything to the Russian Federation just drove people into a frenzy. And I find that absolutely remarkable. I mean, how does anybody expect us to get to a peace deal and stop the killing and prevent a nuclear Armageddon if we, on our side, aren't prepared to compromise at all? I think people need to reflect upon that.
Well, there were a few points that you'd made in your talk when you were in Toronto that I watched, where you said that both China and Russia spend about 30% of what NATO spends on military spending.
Correct.
And that, you know,
yes. China, in fact,
China has like one military base. I forget how many Russia has, but we have, I don't know how many NATO bases there are around the world, but it's got to be in the hundreds. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just saw after I spoke in Toronto, the most recent figures, military spending figures from a Western institution. This is not, you know, from some fringe non-Western institution. And it showed that, I may have the numbers a little bit off because I'm going from memory here, but that in 2022, the People's Republic of China spent something in the range of 290 billion US equivalent on its military. And the Russian Federation, which is involved in a war that it genuinely regards as existential, have spent far less than that, something in the range of, I think it was 87 billion. So you add that up, you get, much less than $400 billion. And the collective, the United States itself is spending somewhere around, I believe, 870 billion in 2022. And all of the NATO countries together are spending $1.2 trillion a year. Trillion. Right. And we're being told that that's not nearly enough. So do the math. NATO collectively is spending in excess of three times Russia and China together.
I'd like to know where on earth all that money goes. Because, it's just a phenomenon. Given the fact that a large part of the materiel that's now being supplied to Ukraine, to the military in Ukraine, is a lot of it's sort of secondhand stuff. I don't know if you ever listened to Scott Ritter, but when he talks about, what they're getting, they're getting refurbished M1 Abrams tanks and things like that. So clearly they're not getting the new stuff. So I wonder if this money is actually just going, it's kind of replacement money or something like that. It's just an astronomical amount of money that I don't think most people can even imagine. Yep. In their minds.
It's mind-blowing. It's mind-blowing. And, if you look at what's happening on the battlefield, you actually look objectively at what's happening on the battlefield, and you listen carefully to what NATO leaders are saying about their depleted weapon supplies, you would, I think, rationally come to, or at least entertain the conclusion, that we are being robbed blind by Western military contractors, because our weaponry doesn't seem to be any better than the Russian weaponry, and in some cases appears to be significantly inferior. For example, the Patriot air defense system seems to be, frankly, a joke, even though it's so expensive, and vastly inferior to the S-400 and S-300s that the Russians have. And you could go on and on across sort of the range of weaponry. Some of the weaponry being produced in the West is, world class, but a lot of it is grossly overrated, and the prices that we're paying for this stuff, which we don't need at all, are exorbitant relative to what the Chinese and the Russians pay. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that their defense industries are essentially state-owned. Mm-hmm. And so their priority is not to maximize profits, as they are, in the United States and other Western countries, including Canada. Mm-hmm. Their priority is to produce the best quality military equipment at the lowest possible price to the state, their owner. And I think that the difference you see, these numbers that I mentioned were real, when I talked about Chinese, Russian military spending, NATO military spending. But in a sense, the discrepancy between these two numbers is illusory, because the West is having to pay, NATO countries are having to pay gigantic profit margins to these military contractors. A lot of that money is just sheer gouging, price gouging. And this has been, this is not a conspiracy theory. This has been documented by Congress and by auditors that have looked at government spending for the military. They can't even conduct an audit of the Pentagon. Huge amounts of money seem to have evaporated. So I go back to what, and of course many of us who have been speaking out about this war go back to those famous words of Eisenhower at the end of his presidency around, the dangerous rise of the military industrial complex. And I commend to everybody who's listening to this a recent interview by Bob Scheer of former CIA analyst Ray McGovern, in which he said it's now gone beyond the military-industrial complex. You have to throw in their Congress. You have to throw in their academia, think tanks, and the media is the fulcrum. All of them together are working in harmony with each other to basically extract from the public treasury every last dime as quickly as possible.
Dimitri, I actually just got back from Canada myself. My parents live in British Columbia on Vancouver Island, and they recently moved into a retirement village. And I had a conversation with one of the fellow, as they affectionately like to call themselves, inmates, although it's not really like that. It's a beautiful location. I mean, anybody who's ever been to BC knows the awesome beauty of the place. But anyway, and I thought this, they point, my parents, we were sitting at dinner in the sort of communal eating space, and my parents, you know, they would point out various, oh, there's, you know, Phil and there's Elaine, and they'd tell me a little bit about each person. And at one point they started talking about this fellow, Fred, and they said, oh, you know, Fred's this nice man and he's from Germany originally, and he seems to travel all over the world. And they waved him over to the table, and he introduced himself. And I don't know how the subject got up. Trust me, I didn't bring it up myself. But he said something along the lines of, well, you know, I have a lot of, I'm originally from what was East Germany. And I said, I'll tell you, young man, there's nothing more important than our freedom. And I have a lot of friends in the Ukrainian Rotary Clubs. And even some of them have gone back to Ukraine to volunteer. And he essentially put forth the idea that if we don't defeat Russia in Ukraine, then we're going to lose that's like the bastion of freedom for the world against both China and Russia. And I had to sort of stop myself from vomiting in my mouth a little bit when I said that. I was just so flabbergasted, but I realized that, you know, this isn't a reasonable person. He's a, you know, Canadian citizen. He's lived in Canada all his life. And I'm sure the people that he associates with are good, decent people. But I was just so dumbfounded by this idea. And so what I wanted to ask you really was, what is your response to people when they say, first of all, that there's no way to have any other outcome to this thing than to actually defeat Russia, and that it's Russia's fault and this is a war crime, and as you mentioned previously, you know, Putin's a dictator.
I have a lot to say to that. I mean, I'll try to
least,
you know, be as concise as possible. First of all, this gentleman, Miss Germany, I mean, I didn't encounter during any of my speeches across Canada, anyone who came from East Germany, but I did encounter people from Eastern Europe, not just Ukrainians, but people from Poland, the Baltic states. And I heard several times, you know, exactly what he said. And my response to them was, I understand why you feel a distrust of Russia. It was the most important part of the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union, the government of the Soviet Union did, you know, act in ways that were oppressive to peoples of Eastern Europe. I don't think its record was entirely negative, by the way, but I certainly understand why people felt that they were deprived of their freedom. But at the same time, if we're being fair, just minimally fair, we would ask, how do the Russians feel about, you know, a Western based military alliance that spends 20 times more than it does on its military and has a history of destroying nation states? How does it feel about having that on its border in light of historical experience? So part of this whole story, you know, of the enmity between Eastern Europe and Russia is the Soviet Union, you know, after the Second World War. The other part of the story, which we don't talk about, is the Second World War. In the Second World War, a Western European nation supported by other European nations like Italy, and I'm talking, of course, of Germany, supported by other Western European nations like Italy, also Romania, and fascist forces in other countries, all the way from France to Ukraine itself.
Well,
launched.
Even Holland had
Absolutely.
Sort of a reserve army of about 100,000 fascists. So, you know,
yeah, I didn't know that, but I'm not remotely surprised, Malcolm, to hear you say that. I mean, this is a fascism was a generalized problem to some degree or another, in the lead up to the Second World War and in the Second World War itself. And what happened to the Soviets, and we're here talking not exclusively about Russia, primarily the Russian people, they suffered tens of millions of casualties, 27 million people the Soviet Union lost, most of them civilians. And there is no country in Europe, and no country in the West, whether we're talking about North America, Europe itself, whatever Western country you may raise as a point and issue, experienced anything along the lines of this historical trauma. And so how do we think the Russians feel when they see Western military forces, including German Leopard tanks, a few hundred miles from Moscow, killing Russian soldiers?
Yeah, I mean, when you see that, the German insignia is identical, the kind of two bars with the white line, that's the same insignia that's always been used by the Wehrmacht since probably about World War One. I mean, that must be extremely triggering. I mean, certainly for the older generation. I mean, not maybe so much for somebody in their 20s that's from Russia, but
And it is the older generations who tend to support Putin more, partly for that reason, because they remember. And so to this gentleman, I would firstly say that, this East German gentleman you spoke to. But the other thing I would say is, this is not the Soviet Union. This is not Stalin. This is a different Russia with far less potency economically and militarily than that of the Soviet Union, but also a different agenda. Like Vladimir Putin has said, and everybody quotes the first part of this passage from a speech that he gave. He said, that the demise of the Soviet Union was a tragedy. That's what we hear. And so everybody says, well, that must mean that he wants to reconstitute the Soviet Union. But then he went on to say in that same speech, so he started out by saying, he who doesn't, feel loss at the demise of the Union doesn't have a heart, but he who wants to rebuild it doesn't have a head. Okay, that part doesn't get told to us. There really is no evidence, no credible evidence, not just me saying this, John Mearsheimer saying this, many others, that Russia wants to reconstitute the Soviet Empire. There's zero evidence. The fact that it invaded Ukraine, well, there's a whole set of reasons why it did that. And you can disagree or not with those reasons, but there really is no evidence that intends to attack a NATO country. And it would have to, in fact, invade a number of them in order to reconstitute the Soviet Empire. This is delusional. This is detached from reality. I think we all need to give our heads a shake and stop buying this line that, if we don't stop Putin here, he's coming for us next. That's a lie, a baseless lie that is designed to get us to support, relentless escalation of this war.
Well, I'm just thinking back to one of the first things you said, and it really resonated with me that, from a legalistic evidence-based, which of course you being a lawyer, it's kind of your specialty. When you look at the evidence, then it starts to make more sense, like in a logical fashion, sort of, so to speak. However,
and that's what we should focus on, the evidence, not on smears directed at those who are talking about the evidence. Sorry, but go ahead.
Well, however, there's always going to be, I encounter this regularly. This look, I mean, even my friend Chris Hedges has said on numerous occasions that Russia's invasion of Ukraine is illegal. It's a war crime. He's said that on many, and I agree with him. It still doesn't absolve, none of this absolves Russia from that basic point. But the discussion that often then occurs is, should we allow, it goes back to the sort of the Neville Chamberlain, peace in our time, the appeasement idea that if we let them get away with this, where is this going to stop? And, so we have to have a response to that. So I'm curious to know what yours is.
Yeah, I had this, exactly this point made to me on my website in response to an article I wrote. I responded to this very same point about appeasement yesterday. And I'll say to you what I said to this gentleman who, you know, suggested that I was being an appeaser. Who's appeasing whom here? I mean, who is really the aggressor here? And how often have we appeased that aggressor and never talked about it? I think one could construct an argument, as I said earlier, that the greatest aggressor of all in this conflict is NATO, and particularly the U.S. government. And if we end up supporting, as I said to this gentleman yesterday on my website, what is in effect a NATO-led and Biden-led proxy war against Russia, I could make a quite persuasive case that we are appeasing the world's greatest aggressor of all, the United States government. And in fact, that's precisely what we've been doing, Malcolm. We've been doing it for decades. When we didn't hold the global community, anybody in the United States government accountable for the war crimes and crimes against humanity committed in Vietnam and Laos and Cambodia, we appeased the U.S. government. When we didn't hold any of them accountable for the lies upon which the criminal war criminal aggression war against Iraq was waged, we appeased the U.S. government. When we didn't hold anybody in the Bush administration responsible for what was admitted to be a program of torturing people who had been convicted of no crime, a number of whom had been completely innocent of any crime, we were appeasing the U.S. government. And even today, human rights groups have said, Western-based human rights group, that what's happening at Guantanamo currently is a crime against humanity. And nobody's doing a damn thing about that in the West. Right. We are, in effect, appeasing the U.S. government. We've done it over and over again. And I would suggest to those who are concerned about appeasement that if you support this proxy war, you are repeating a historical pattern of appeasing the country, the state. It's not the country, it's the government. That has been the most aggressive violator of international law in the post-World War II period.
Again, to sort of play devil's advocate, you know, the accusation then to you or myself would be, oh, you're just playing whataboutism, you know, like instead of addressing the issue of the Russians' failures and war crimes, we're sort of deflecting that and say, oh yes, but what about this? And what I often get is this idea from people that I'm just essentially down on America. Like, and yeah, people will say, well, why, you know, you're so busy criticizing United States, but you're letting these other countries like China and Russia get away with these human rights abuses and war crimes and things like that. Why aren't you more concerned about that? Well, I know what my answer is. I'm curious to hear yours.
Well, I think people who say that, and by the way, I wrote a long article about this a few months ago. It's on my website, and it's called A Whataboutist Response to the Useful Idiots of the Anglo-American Empire. And I give a whole bunch of reasons why I focus on the crimes of the West. You know, if anybody wants to see the lengthy explanation I give for that, I'm happy for that to do it. I'm very comfortable with my position in that regard. But with respect specifically to this conflict, let's just talk about this conflict for a second. Okay. What I'm saying is not an attempt to distract attention from the illegality of the invasion. And the very first article I wrote about this, which I published on my website 2 days after the invasion began, and it's been up on my website ever since, including when I was in Russia, I offered a legal analysis that the invasion violated the United Nations Charter, and I condemned it unequivocally. And that remains my position to this day. But I also argued vociferously that NATO had provoked the war. And what I'm saying is that, first of all, because we have constantly appeased the U.S. government, we have no moral authority to tell any non-Western state that it has to hold its leaders accountable for violating international law. But secondly, if we allow, and this is my greater concern, if we allow yet again the United States government and its vassal states in the West to get away with provoking a war, and using a terribly, you know, a people who now experience unspeakable suffering, the people of Ukraine, to get away with using them cynically as cannon fodder, what we're doing is we are incentivizing the United States government to continue this behavior. The United States government has to be made eventually to pay a price for its grotesque misconduct. And I would say to you that if we impose upon the Russians a one-sided deal, which, I, by the way, I don't think we're capable of doing that, even if we thought that was the right course of action, it ain't going to happen. They have a nuclear arsenal, and before they are forced to capitulate, I suspect they would use it. So people need to be thinking very carefully about that. But let's put that aside, okay? If we allow the American government and its allies again to get away with this disgraceful interference into the domestic affairs of other states and this provocative behavior, it will only continue to behave in this manner. And the next target will be China. That's very clear. And if we manage somehow miraculously to avoid World War III in this conflict, we ain't going to do that when they go after China. It's time to put a stop to this behavior on both sides. And that means we have to tell the U.S. government and its Western allies, you too must compromise, because you yourselves are aggressors and you have been violating international law relentlessly for decades with complete impunity. And we're not going to put up with it anymore. We need to do that for the collective security of humanity now, not later, now.
Well, I can't say I disagree with you at all on that level. You know, it's been 20 odd years now since I've just been, you know, especially living in this country, you know, just seeing this endless litany. I mean, you know, who was it was saying, I think just yesterday, it was, I can't remember who was being interviewed by whom on what program, but they were saying, you know, essentially America has screwed up every military conflict it's been involved in since Vietnam. And
including Vietnam,
and the only winners have been, you know, the war profiteers. And as Major General Smedley Butler once wrote, war is a racket, and, you know, it seems like they're all in on it. Mm-hmm. I have two last questions I'd like to ask you before I let you go. The first question is, having spent that amount of time in Russia, I'm sure you had fairly good impressions, despite the cynics who may say that you were being told a bunch of lies by propagandists and, you know, the tropes.
Yeah.
I'd like to get your impression of what, quote, you know, the average Russian, how they feel about what's going on. Do they care? Is it a big deal? Is it supportive of, you know, is there an anti-war movement in Russia, for example, that you might have become aware of?
So, you know, I want to preface my answer by pointing out, as I have many times, I didn't, you know, conduct any kind of a poll. So the sample, so I spoke to dozens of people, which is a statistically insignificant sample size, and I can't say that they were randomly selected. So what I heard may not necessarily be representative of what the Russian people generally think. But I think that if you look at polls, for example, from Levada, which is generally considered in the West to be a reputable polling agency in Russia.
Levada?
Levada, L-E-V as in Victor, A-D as in David, A.
Okay.
It's the Levada Center. And its management, by the way, happens to be quite critical of Vladimir Putin. So this is not some kind of sycophantic organization. They are the real deal. And the polls that they put out support what I myself heard in the streets and speaking to ordinary Russians. You know, what they show is that currently the approval rating for the government of Vladimir Putin is in excess of 80%, slightly in excess of 80%. And they also, interestingly, they show that in a recent poll that slightly more, I think it was approximately 48% of Russians think that this war must continue until the enemy is completely defeated, and somewhat less, moderately less than that, would like to see peace negotiations. But I don't think that tells us much about how they feel about what an appropriate peace deal would look like. In speaking to people, I found consistently that they feel that Russia is involved in an existential war. Very widespread feeling in Russia, based on what I heard, that the real enemy here is not Ukraine, it's NATO. Mm-hmm. This is a war between NATO and Russia. I heard a lot of people say that they don't think that Zelensky is a legitimate representative of the Ukrainian people, that in fact they are victims of his own misconduct and betrayal, and that this war has to be won. And to the extent there was criticism of Vladimir Putin's government, it was not from the doves and the anti-war critics. That's, I'm just talking, of course, of what I myself heard. What I heard, and there was some criticism, is that the Russian government should have intervened much earlier before NATO built up the Ukrainian military into a very formidable fighting force. And secondly, that now that it's in this conflict with, direct military intervention, it needs to be more aggressive in prosecuting this war to a successful conclusion. I didn't encounter any Russians who, condemned what the government is doing in Ukraine. As I say, there was criticism that it wasn't being aggressive enough, but nobody that I spoke to said that it should never have gone in at all. Some people did say to me that at the beginning of the war, they felt that way. But as time has gone by, they have become convinced that, in fact, NATO is trying to destroy Russia, and that one way or another, this was a conflict that was going to occur, and that there was no way to avoid it other than, complete capitulation to NATO. So people need to, I think, reflect carefully on these sentiments, and particularly, the point that I just mentioned, that some people at the beginning were critical of the invasion and changed their minds. And what I really want to impress upon people is our behavior, I believe, is radicalizing the Russian population. We're trying to turn them against the president. I think we are actually making them more hostile to the West through our actions. And that's very, very dangerous.
Well, war has a funny way of doing that, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. It tends to polarize people. And, people that were on the fence, have to ultimately often pick a side, which is sad because, it radically diminishes room for discussion and negotiation, because the more people get, somebody said yesterday or somewhere, some recent poll, that most Americans, apart from the fact that they couldn't point to Ukraine on a map if you asked them to, not through anyone's fault, it's just not that important, but for most Americans, but they also don't even really care that much about this thing. It's, it's not in the national interest. That's the thing that's really baffling to me. It's not in the national, I don't think most Americans feel that way. And I'm sorry to say it, but, a carnival barker like Donald Trump is going to pick up on that and run with it and use that, and then of course, if you're anti-war, people say, well, you must be a Trump supporter because you're anti-war, which is really like an Orwellian mind, pardon the word, feck, as they say in Ireland.
Cornel West was on CNN, I think, in the last day or two, in which he was saying things very similar about this war that I just, have been discussing with you. And, Glenn Greenwald commented, he drew attention to some of the reactions at CNN and other liberal commentators about Dr. West's attitude towards this war. And they were comparing him to Trump. They were comparing Cornel West.
It's really,
it's amazing.
It's like that line from 1984, war is peace, ignorance is strength, or whatever. There's like three parts to that quote from Orwell's 1984.
Yeah,
it does seem very Orwellian. Well, look, my last question for you, and I suppose this is a pretty big one, but I'd like to ask you, if you were, the master of the universe, or at least the planet, and you could just wave your magic wand and say, well, here's what has to happen, here's what should happen in Ukraine now, what would you say that would be? What would you wish to see?
Well, what I would wish to see...
First step is what I mean to say.
Well, if I were truly, if I were truly the master of the universe, everybody would, get along. And they'd lay down their weapons and there wouldn't be fights over territory. And they'd all say we're, brothers and sisters, family, and let's get to the heart of business of resolving this climate emergency. And, we don't need to fight over land. We don't need to fight over territory. We can forgive each other, and that's the end of it. But I also am realistic, and I understand that it ain't going to happen. Not in my lifetime, unfortunately. So I have to deal with reality. I'm not the master of the universe. And the reality is that Ukraine is a deeply divided country. It's more divided now than it has ever been. And there are people, millions of them, living in the southeastern part of the country and in Crimea, who want nothing to do with the government in Kiev anymore. I met a lot of these people. And then there are people living in the western part of the country and in some parts of the, you know, Ukrainian territory east of the Dnieper River, who are intensely hostile to Russia and feel very strongly that the government in Kiev is a legitimate representative of the Ukrainian people. And if we don't find some way of, you know, separating these two groups, I don't think there's going to be an end to the bloodshed. I just think that's the reality. So it's, I don't want to see, you know, Ukraine partitioned. I have no desire to see that happen. I just want the war to end and for us to stop the killing and avoid a nuclear holocaust on terms that are durable. And I think that the only way that realistically can happen is through some form of partition. So people then say to me, well, you'd be rewarding the aggressor. Well, I have two things to say to that. First of all, again, it's not as simple as there's one aggressor and the other side is a pure victim for all the reasons I stated. But the other thing that I would say about, you know, this whole question of rewarding the aggressor is there's something called the right to self-determination. It's a human right. It has been recognized repeatedly as such, particularly by the United Nations General Assembly. And so why don't we let the people living in these areas make the decision themselves? There were referenda. I understand that people have criticisms of those referenda. For example, they were held in times of war, which creates serious concerns about their validity. You know, a lot of the people who would have been entitled to vote in that referendum or those referenda in times of peace had fled. So they weren't afforded the opportunity to vote. So they're legitimate criticisms. Okay, fine. Let's sit down at the table and let's figure out on what terms referenda can be held again, plebiscites. And once the two sides, the Ukrainians and the Russians, agree on the terms of the plebiscites will be conducted by the United Nations or some other neutral arbiter. And both sides will be obliged by way of treaty to respect the vote of the people. And if people want to be part of Ukraine, great, you know, great. And Russia should respect that. If people want to be part of Russia in these areas, Ukraine should respect that. And who knows, maybe the vote will be that they want to be independent of both of those countries. We should respect that too. Okay. It's the right to self-determination, and it's a right that they all have. And I think that's the best way to deal with this, you know, really thorny issue and probably the thorniest issue in this dispute, and that is territorial concessions.
Well, it's painful to see. I mean, I get these video uploads from various sources on a daily basis. I'm sure you've seen some of them. And the suffering that's occurring on both sides is just, I mean, not to underwhelm what's going on in other places in the world, like Darfur or Sudan or places like that. But what you see in this war is human beings just being squashed like bugs, like
blown apart. Yes, absolutely. Maimed, disabled. It's beyond horrific. You know, I've seen those same videos, Malcolm.
You know, people are literally being melted. You know, it's just so heartbreaking. But so, yeah, I think we both, and anyone who's listening who has a heart, I think would agree. The first thing is to just, you know, okay, let's have a ceasefire. And I think anybody who says a ceasefire doesn't work might look at North and South Korea. I mean, that's literally a 70-year-old ceasefire. Okay, it's not perfect, but, you know, that's an example of a situation that, you know, could be applied, I suppose, on some level. Well, look, I do appreciate your time, and I wish you all the best, and I have to say, I envy you your geographic location. I love Greece. I've been there three times. And I don't know where you are, but the places I've been are just wonderful places, and the people are phenomenal. And on that note, I'm going to continue the rest of the show with some selections of, well, I'm going to start off with a track by Pix Lax. So you don't have to stay and listen to the rest of the music, Dimitri, but perhaps you could just do us a favor of introducing this first song. The
Pix Lax was
the track.
Yeah, Astinale, Let Her Speak. You know, Pix Lax is one of the most loved rock bands in Greek history, and they had a really you know, progressive outlook, left-wing outlook on life, and but had a way of expressing a kind of revolutionary vision that was very endearing and inspiring, and resonated with sort of ordinary Greeks. And they did a tour, I believe it was the most attended tour in the history of Greek rock. So I hope people will appreciate this song as much as I do.
Well, thank you very much, Dimitri. I wish you well, safe travels, power to
thank you.
And we'll talk to you again.
Always a pleasure, brother. Take care.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Έτσι πρέπει για χαρά, εσύ θα κρίζεις. Σου είπε πως επέρασε πολλά, θέλει να φύγει. Δεν έμαθε ποτέ της να αγαπά και είναι μόνη. Δεν έμαθε ποτέ της να πονά και σε πληγώνει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, εκείνη μόνο ξέρει και μέσα της τα κλαίει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, εκείνη μόνο ξέρει και μέσα της τα κλαίει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει.
Κι αν έφυγε και πήγε μακριά, αυτή θα χάσει. Σου ράγισε για λίγο την καρδιά, ας σου περάσει. Δεν έμαθε ποτέ της να αγαπά και είναι μόνη. Δεν έμαθε ποτέ της να πονά και σε πληγώνει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, εκείνη μόνο ξέρει και μέσα της τα κλαίει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, εκείνη μόνο ξέρει και μέσα της τα κλαίει. Ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει, ας τι να λέει.
Well, I hope you enjoyed my interview with Dimitri Lascaris.
And I'd urge you to go to his website, DimitriLascaris.com. You can see more about him and the great work that he does and a lot of his writings and so forth that he referred to in the interview. In this hour, I'm going to feature some music, some of which is a tribute to him and his Greek heritage. We heard Astinele by the group Pix Lax, which was Dimitri's suggestion. Thank you. I loved hearing that song. It's great to discover something new. And I'm now going to play a piece. It's from an album that my mom bought me. Well, she bought herself, but she gave it to me. I liked it so much. Back in the early 70s, it's a film that was called by Costa Gavras, the Greek filmmaker. And the film was called State of Siege. And in the film is about during the overthrow of the socialist but democratically elected president of Chile, Salvador Allende, who was ultimately overthrown and assassinated and replaced by an actual live-in-the-flesh, goose-stepping fascist named Augusto Pinochet, who turned out to be one of Margaret Thatcher's best friends. The film centers around a CIA advisor who has been sent down, and this is a true story, by the way, was sent down to Chile to advise the secret police in torture methods. And this particular individual was kidnapped by the opposition and held for ransom. Ultimately, I think he was killed, but it didn't stop the CIA and the fascist forces from torturing literally thousands of Chilean socialists and otherwise unsavory characters who didn't want to fall into the goose-step line. So this is a track composed by Mikis Theodorakis. Mikis Theodorakis, you'll be happy to know, composed the music for Zorba the Greek and The Missing, starred Jack Lemmon, and quite a number of other films. And I always loved this piece of music because I think it was one of the early moments where I felt that my mother instilled in me a sense of justice and standing up for the little people, the little guy, the common people, against the powers of oppression. Thank you. State of Siege, Part 2, composed by Mikis Theodorakis from the film State of Siege, which happened to star Yves Montand, played the CIA agent, and as I said, it's a true story. Here's a track, I don't speak any Russian, but I like the title of it. It's called Dark is the Night, and the track is by an artist named The Negotiator.
Темная ночь, только пули свистят по степи, только ветер гудит в проводах, тускло звезды мерцают. В темную ночь ты, любимая, знаю, не спишь, и у детской кроватки тайком ты слезу утираешь. Как я люблю глубину твоих ласковых глаз, как я хочу к ним прижаться теперь губами. Темная ночь разделяет, любимая, нас, и тревожная черная степь пролегла между нами. Верю в тебя, дорогую подругу мою, эта вера от пули меня темной ночью хранила. Радостно мне, я спокоен в смертельном бою, знаю, встретишь с любовью меня, чтоб со мной не случилось. Смерть не страшна, с ней встречались не раз мы в степи. Вот и теперь надо мною она кружится. Ты меня ждешь, и у детской кроватки не спишь, и поэтому знаю, со мной ничего не случится. И поэтому знаю, со мной ничего не случится.
Thank you.
That was Pharaoh with Gistenemy, one of the most popular modern rapper pop stars in Russia at the moment. Track on Blood Oceans from the album Blood Oceans, How Many? Going into the last half hour of the show, I'd like to play a song. This is from an album that I produced and recorded for the Neville Brothers, called, and the album itself is called Brother's Keeper. It's a track written by Link Ray, and it's a song ostensibly about veterans, probably of the Vietnam War. I think it's a very moving song, because we often forget the aftermath of war is lived by the veterans who are disabled, both mentally and physically, for the rest of their lives. When the parades are over and the glory stops, but their lives continue, falling rain.
I hear a sound, it's going through my brain. I hear talking, I feel the falling rain. I see a young man crying, 'cause the whole world has let him down. I see a young man crying, staring at the cold, cold ground. My mind is like a spring in a clock that won't unwind. Can't see, can't think, can't feel, I'm out of time. I'm up and I'm down, tell me where will it end? On this carousel, tell me when will it end? I hear thunder and I can feel the wind. I can see angry faces in the eyes of men. I hear talking of people, the whole world is gone insane. And all there is left is the falling rain. See fire and rain and bloodshed all around, and it keeps going through my brain. I hear the sound, I hear talking of people, the whole world is gone insane, and all that is left is the falling rain. All there is left is the falling rain. All that is left is the falling rain.
Just give me some truth. No short head, yellow belly, summer. Father's boys, father's boys,
your boys,
your boys, but also in the end, our boys too.
It was out at that place called Kahima, where most of the fighting was done. 'Twas there that a lad from the borders fell to a Japanese gun. Now as he lay there in the jungle, and the blood from his wounds did flow red, he gathered his comrades around him, and these were the words that he said: "Oh, bury me out in the jungle, under the old Burma sun. Bury me out in the jungle, my duty to England is done." So they buried him out in the jungle, by the light of the far-setting sun. They buried him out in the jungle, his job for his country was done. Now when you get back to old England, and the war is all over and won. Just remember that poor British Tommy.
The Dying Soldier, performed by the Sods Opera. Before that, we heard Carry the Earth, Le Trio Joubran, featuring Roger Waters. Of course, John Lennon, what would he say if he was around today? Imagine peace. And to start off, we heard the Neville Brothers with Fallen Rain. Thank you, Liz Hill, for being the producer of the show and providing me with these lyrics, the English lyrics to the track I played earlier, the Russian song, The Dark Night. And the words say, "The dark night, the night is dark, only bullets are whizzing over the steppe, only wind rumbles in the wires, and faded stars twinkle. I know that you don't sleep in this dark night, my lovely, and you secretly wipe your tears by the cradle. I love you so much, the depth of your gentle eyes, I want to touch them now with my lips. The dark night divides us, my lovely, and severe black step was pushed between you and me. I do believe in you, my dear friend. This faith prevented me from the bullets and the dark night. I'm glad and calm in this deadly fight, because I know that you will show me love, no matter what wrong happens to me. The death is not scary. We've faced it many times on the steppe, and even now it circles around me. We're waiting for me, and you cannot sleep by the cradle. That's why I know nothing wrong will happen to me." Thank you.
ήλιο σκοτεινιάζει. Το δόλιο το μικρό χωριό και πάλι ανταριάζει. Αμποκοπούν χρυσά σπαθιά, πέφτουν ντουφέ κι αναριά. Ο Άρης κάνει πόλεμο, βαντάρτες παλικάρια.
Well, unfortunately, it's time to say goodbye. We're listening to Petros Pandis, Songs of the Greek Resistance. Before that, we heard Immunity by John Hopkins. Stay tuned for Nick Pankin. He's got a special treat for you tonight, Freedom Highway. And if good Lord's willing and the creek don't rise, we'll see you next week.